Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Sounds kind of weird now, doesn't it? I mean, the Valentine's candy's already out. It was out the day after Christmas. It's always been kind of confusing, and our secular world and our secular customs creep in around and push things out, and sometimes it's confusing how long the Christmas season is. About 25 years ago, I was attending midnight mass at St. Mary's Church in Hartsville, South Carolina. At about 12:20, the priest began his homily. 12:20 in the morning, and this particular priest liked to give his homily patrolling the middle aisle, about the first five rows. And if you sat in those first five rows, you were on the firing line, because he may turn to you and ask you a direct question, and he required an answer. This particular morning was no different. As he walked the line out there back and forth, he looked down at one of the parishioners. I don't remember his name, but I will say his name was Joe. And he looked and he said, "Joe, how many days are there in Christmas?" And Joe immediately began to try to become invisible. He shivered, he shook, he stuttered, he just couldn't figure. And the priest turned to him again and said, "How many days are in Christmas, Joe? I know you know the answer." And all he could do was stutter and carry on. And finally, the priest threw him a lifeline and said, "Joe, there's a song, The Blank Days of Christmas." And more of a question, he said sputteringly, "12? And he said, "I knew you knew it all the time, Joe." So we all know it, but sometimes we forget it. And so in the United States, Christmas season is from the eve of Christmas on the 24th to the baptism of our Lord, which is today. On the last day of Christmas, tomorrow, it will be a stark change when you come into this sanctuary. Gone will be all the Christmas decorations. Gone will be the nativity scene. The wise men and camels will have gone back east to the vesting sacristy and taken their place upon the tops of the cabinets back there, covering themselves in plastic till next year. Gone are all vestiges. The white will be gone and we'll be back in green, except on special days. But today we're here to celebrate the baptism of our Lord. In our gospel reading today, we have a unique picture that's painted. We find John the Baptist in the desert at the Jordan River baptizing. Now, as he's described in Scripture, he is a man who is dressed in a camel hair garment with a leather belt. He lives in the wild and he eats insects, specifically locusts, and he has as a main course wild honey. Having been a beekeeper for some time in my life, I learned a quick rule: the bees are not very responsive to you taking their honey. So I can picture this man here preaching to the crowds, wearing this attire with stings from bees upon him, preaching the word of God. The Holy Spirit was with him, and maybe it was people's curiosity too, but they all came out. In Matthew's gospel, we even find the Pharisees and Sadducees there with him. We find soldiers there with him. We find everyone, tax collectors, all came out. The gospel today tells us the people were in anticipation. They were expecting. They knew that their belief was that Elijah was going to come back ahead of the Christ. Was this Elijah? Was this the Christ? As he preaches to the crowd, he preaches a baptism of repentance. A baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And this one crying in the desert was preaching to the people. In Matthew's gospel, Jesus approaches John and asks him to baptize him, and John wanted no part because John felt unworthy. John said, "You should be baptizing me." And so in the gospel lesson today, we find that John is being asked by the people, "Are you the Christ?" And he says, "No, the one coming is so much greater than I. His baptism is of the Holy Spirit and fire. But he is so great that I'm not even worthy to untie his shoelaces." which was one of the lowest duties of a servant to his master in those times. John baptized Jesus. He baptized the people. And as today's gospel, as Jesus is praying after baptism, the heavens are opened. The heavens that were closed by the sins of Adam and Eve are opened. And the Holy Spirit descends like a dove upon Jesus. And a voice says, "You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased." And with that, with Jesus' baptism, he begins his public ministry at about 30 years of age. This was the beginning of his public ministry. Now, the big question here is, why was Jesus baptized? If that particular priest was here walking through the crowd and he pointed at you and said, "Why was Jesus baptized? Jesus never committed a sin. Jesus was not born with original sin. Why did he need to be baptized?" The answer maybe is more simple than we give it credit for, and that is because of Jesus' humility. Jesus humbled himself to be one of us, one of his creation. Very much God, very much man. Every Mass, the priest or the deacon, as the wine and the water are mixed, says a very quiet prayer. "By the mystery of this water and wine, may we come to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity." And that is the answer. So the other question, the bigger question is, what then is baptism to us? What is baptism to you? Most of us were baptized when we were infants. We don't even remember the time. Somebody might have took one of those old 8mm back in the day, or somebody may video it now, but you don't remember it. Now, you may remember the other sacraments as you come into the church of receiving the Eucharist and penance and then confirmation, but baptism was a long time ago. At the time you were baptized as an infant, the church and your parents and your godparents promised to raise you in the faith. So what does your baptism mean to you now? What is baptism? Well, first of all, Jesus requires baptism to enter the kingdom of heaven. So Jesus requires it. But once you're baptized, as John was preaching, baptism and repentance. Repentance comes with baptism. And for us, even though our baptism was a long time away, it should be with us every day. For those of us who are married, once you have the marriage ceremony, the big ceremony and the reception and a honeymoon, and the honeymoon's over and you're together, for a successful marriage, what has to happen? The relationship has to stay alive. You have to work together and live together and love together your entire life. If you don't, you grow apart and the marriage fails. If you're in holy orders, every day that you wake up, you are renewing your commitment to Christ every day, or your ministry fails. So in our lives today, where do we stand with renewing the faith? Every day. We live our baptism as Christians every day. That is the point. That is what we are doing. We are to work to develop a relationship with Christ, which is taught to us throughout the Gospels by Christ and by the Gospel writers. We live our faith, we repent every day, and we come to love Christ more every day of our life. Jesus was asked at one point, what was the most important commandment? And you remember that, don't you? The first commandment, to love God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength. With everything you do, your life is separate, it's centered on God. Is your life centered on God? That's the question to ask every day. Is your life centered on God? Does everything you do come from God? Or do we do like people like to do, which is compartmentalize our lives? We come to church at this time. We eat at this time. We go to work at this time. We act this way at work. We act this way at home. We compartmentalize what we do. But that's not what baptism and repentance and conversion is all about. It's about living our faith. When there's a conflict between something in the secular world and what God wants us to do, which one wins in our life? If we're true followers of Christ, then God wins every time. God comes first every single time. And the second response Jesus gave is a lot harder, I think, than the first. And that is, we are to love one another as we love ourselves. And sometimes that can be kind of hard, can't it? We have personality conflicts. We don't like somebody. But when Jesus says, love your neighbor, he drills it down to the parable of the Good Samaritan. Even those people that abjectly hate us, we are to love. And that can be a very hard road to hoe. If you're sitting here right now and you have a grievance against someone, you need to discern and correct that. Jesus is very clear about mending relationships between people. So today, we're reminded that Jesus tells us in the Gospel of John that I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. We come to Jesus through our baptism, and we stay with Jesus by living our life with him. We live our baptism every day. There can be no compromises with that. Every day that we wake up, we should remember the words of John the Baptist. Repent, the kingdom of God is at hand.